Hey guys, Dave from Nerdarchy, four nerds, by nerds, hang out with this nerd.
Nerdarchist Ted.
And we're delving back into the Starfinder core rulebook to look at races. This time we're looking at the Shirren.
Jump down in the description below where you can sign up for Nerdarchy the newsletter, get weekly gaming tips, as well as learn how to game with Nerdarchy.
Not only that, while you're down there, you can find a link to get your copy of Starfinder.
All right. So we're diving back into Starfinder. We're on page 50, and we're looking at races.
Yeah, the Shirrens, you know, and if we go right to the top, it kind of gives you, you know, a little bit of the information about their stats and their hit points, as they all do. So they're hardy, and they're, you know, either you consider them either perceptive or strong-willed or wise, you know, but, you know, they're not quite so likable. They're kind of weird, and they're at the top of the food chain when it comes to hit points.
They're the bug people, you know. They belonged or used to belong as a race to this all-encompassing swarm, and that -2 to charisma that they get really is because a lot of people are worried that at some point in time they might just turn on a switch or turn off the switch, however you want to look at it, and go back to being, you know, mind controlled.
Now, you know, size and type. They're medium-sized humanoids. Their type is Shirren, like everybody else in here. They have a nifty ability called Blind Sense, and this functions via vibrations. So at the 30 feet, they really don't need their eyes. They're going to be hard to deceive and sneak around on.
Right. So they get communalism. So as long as there's an ally once a day within 10 feet, they can roll twice and take the better results.
Yeah, and this kind of harkens back to them being part of a swarm and being used to working with others.
Right. So then they get the cultural fascination, which, because they're so fascinated with individualism and working as a team, they get to get a +2 racial bonus to culture and diplomacy checks.
Which is good. I mean, it kind of offsets that -2 to charisma.
It does.
Now, they also have limited telepathy. There's only, so far, there's only one other race that has telepathy, and that's Lashana's. Well, these guys also have it, and they can talk to people from mind to mind.
Winds up being the exact same power that the Lashuntas get, and it's within 30 feet, and it's like, okay, well, you can talk to multiple people, just like you can listen to multiple people as it would be in a normal conversation.
Right. They don't need their mouth, they don't need their ears.
So, since they're part of the swarm, they really don't know where their home planet is, don't have a home planet, however you want to look at it. At some point in time in the not so far distant history, they broke apart from the swarm and began to settle wherever and whenever they could get.
Yeah, they're basically, we're going back to what we've seen in pretty much every other race up until this point, is no one has a home world. You know, only the Lashantas have had one. And oddly enough, the Lashantas are the only ones that don't really like these guys. Well, dislike them the most so far. Out of the races we've seen, and they like everybody, but they're like, ah, those guys freaking creep me out. So these guys are interesting in the sense that, one, of everything we've seen, these are the most alien-looking so far.
Yes, you know, they are, as I said, they're giant bug people. And when I look at the picture, I'm curious to know whether they have the mouth or whether this whole, like, neck thing opens up and they've got a gigantic maw. I can't really tell. And part of me wants it to be that massive maw that they can just shove things into.
Oh my God. It's like a food chute.
Right. Because they've got what looks like a mouth with regular mandibles or teeth or whatever you want to call them. But then there's more that go down what looks like its neck.
Well, also, the thing that you don't see in the picture that they mention is they have another set of arms that they really don't use except for during breeding and mating.
Yes.
So it's like, that's kind of weird. You got to do a handshake. Like, whoa, what are you doing, buddy?
And it literally draws out that if you, like, if they use them for anything else in public, like, that's like, whoa.
What do you, put that away, buddy. What are you doing? Away. Yeah, so that's kind of funny.
But also related to that, they don't have the typical male-female pairing. They have male, female, and host. So in some parts of their culture, you could have a host that is hosting multiple other couples, or you could have a three-person marriage to actually get the procreation done. So this is the first time you're actually seeing anything that breaks away from, you know, tradition.
Yeah, it's definitely, that's definitely, it's a different dynamic, and it's going to change the way their society interacts. But it also goes back to how communal they are as well.
So I wish I had had more time to actually see whether there was actually any insects in our real world that function like this, because I haven't done a lot of entomology study in my life, but I haven't heard anything like this before.
Now you have an unanswered question that needs answering.
So any insect nuts out there that, you know, happen to know anything about this? Did they pull this out of thin air, or did they pull it out of our world biology?
Yeah. So one of the things you kind of touched on a little bit earlier is the fact that they're like obsessed with making individual choices because they were part of this swarm hive mind for so long. Matter of fact, part of their chemical makeup is when they make individual decisions, it stimulates their pleasure senses.
Right.
You know, it makes them feel good. So literally, you have choice junkies among this race. And it's also why they're also kind of like really agreeable, because they just want to meet new people and experience new things. So, you know, it all stems from more choices they make.
So literally, you know, what weapon am I going to use? What am I going to have for breakfast? Little things like this that most people will just not have a thought on.
Take for granted.
Yeah. These guys relish that. And I think that's awesome.
Oh, you know, also when you get into like the adventurer section, it's like these guys are all about the non-combat roles if they can. I mean, that being said, like they're fiercely loyal because of that community thing. You don't want to mess with their people, but at the same time, like they kind of abhor violence, and they're like the peacekeepers of the group, and they want to mediate. They want to find common ground. They kind of like want to fix stuff, so they make like really good mystics and mechanics.
Right. And I would imagine that, you know, despite the fact that they get a -2 to charisma, I think if you push charisma heavy, I think they can make pretty cool envoys as well.
Yeah, their makeup is kind of leans towards that. So yeah, I would agree.
So then with their names, I think it's actually pretty interesting. Since they do most of their communication via telepathy, they really don't like vocalization unless they're actually forced to do it. So they actually have names that are pretty difficult for most humanoids to actually pronounce, but their actual name is communicated telepathically through a series of emotions. So like part of me is like, okay, you know, how would I come up with this? You know, would it be like, you know, happy sun cloud, you know, breakfast, you know, would that be something that would that would fit, you know, this kind of character? And but, you know, aside from that, because they're so into pleasing others and what have you, they actually think it's an honor if somebody else gives them a name that's easier for them to pronounce. So I think that really stems to the adventuring party thing. Even if it's something, you know, silly or even possibly somewhat insulting, I think they would actually get a kick out of someone else giving them a nickname.
That is like a cool factor. And also part of it is their physiology as well when it comes to, you know, their names and their speech names, right? Part of that problem is because they have mandibles and their mouth structure is different than a lot of other races. So it makes it more difficult for those other races to actually pronounce the sounds that they're making, which to them, you know, might come off as like clicks and pops and, you know, kind of like these really like what you would attribute as like insect-like noises.
Or the names here kind of remind me of like Thrycreen names.
Yeah, absolutely. That would make sense because both happen to be bug people.
Indeed.
So one of the cool things about the Shirrens, and same thing like with the androids for me, is certain races just speak to me and go, oh, this is a built-in plot hook in the campaign setting. The fact that the swarm could come back, what happens if the swarm comes back, does it have a way of taking the Shirrens back over? Maybe it's not just a switch, but maybe they can capture them and convert them back. Maybe there's particular entities within the swarm that have the ability to convert them back. So like these could all be interesting things in your game. And not only that though, like I could definitely see the Shirrens being, you know, this race that would abhor actually being absorbed back into the swarm. Like I could definitely see like the Shirren being like, hey, look, if they get me, please put this bullet in my head.
Yeah, I kind of was thinking along that same lines of, you know, as I'm reading it, and I'm like, well, there was a sect of them that broke off. Well, I don't know whether I missed it, whether there's more in the history that I didn't see yet. But to me, I'm like, well, the swarm could still be out there. So
If I'm running Starfinder, the swarm is absolutely still out there.
So yeah, exactly. So I was like, all right, well, as you said, like, could they be reabsorbed? Could it be just this is an enemy to fight? And what would drive a Shirren to actually engage in combat more so than fighting against? They don't even consider it their own race anymore because they're the swarm. These guys are the Shirrens.
Yeah, you know, fighting for their right to kind of exist as individuals would be a huge catalyst for them. You could do a whole campaign arc on this. You could foreshadow it with other Shirrens showing up, but they're the swarm Shirrens. Mm. You know, where they don't act like the Shirrens you're used to, especially if you encounter like one, right?
Right.
And it keeps like we or us. You know,
yeah, that would actually be really, really an interesting dynamic or an interesting role playing encounter where it's not using the singular, and like anyone who knows enough about, you know, their culture would kind of be frightened about, okay, well, we're seeing this quote unquote envoy to the swarm. What do we do? How do you handle this? Do we kill it now? Will that make a difference? Will that do anything? Will that egg them on further? Will it scare them away?
Is it already too late? You know, they are coming kind of deal. And then, like, you know, who knows when it happens in the game. But, you know, so I feel like these guys have a great backstory as a race that could really fuel a whole campaign. Like, you could literally do a war against the swarm as your campaign, and that would be a lot of fun.
I entirely agree. I think that would be fantastic, and that would actually give me like a major incentive to want to play a Shirren fighting against that.
Yeah, you know, you could literally do the Shirren version, or not the Shirren, but the swarm version of the Borg.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
What if they've moved beyond, you know, assimilating and taking in these races, but now they're also taking in their technology like the Borg do, and the swarm is an even greater threat than it had ever been. You know, or you can literally just rip it right off and, like, they literally are just Borg now and just use that right in your game. It's your home game. Who cares?
So, what do you guys think? Are you playing Starfinder? What do you think of the Shirrens? There's a great place to continue that conversation. That's down in the discussion, down in the comments below. While you're down there, don't forget to like, share, and subscribe.
You can check the description and grab your copy of Starfinder today.
So, until next time, stay nerdy.